Hello everyone, welcome back to the NABARD Grade A 5-day question series. And as you know, ART holds around 40 marks in the phase 1 examination. So it's very important to just get through the concepts before you go for the examination. In this video, I'm going to take up the topic forestry. Now let's begin with the first question. So now the question, which of the following is true with respect to the reserve forest and protected forest? Now there's a very minute difference between this reserve forest and protected forest. Let's look at these statements. So the first statement is rights to all activities like hunting, grazing is banned in reserve forest but given in protected forest. Now this statement might seem right to you, but it is always advisable in the examination to go through all the options and then choose the correct answer. Reason being that we need to always choose the most appropriate answer, and therefore there can be situations when you might feel that one or two options are correct. So first go through all the options, then mark the answer. So as of now, this statement seems correct. Next is right to all activities like hunting, grazing is banned in protected forest. Now it is incorrect. It is not banned in protected forest. Next is the right to entry for collection of timber is prohibited in reserve forest and protected forest. It's not true with the protected forest, similar statement. So this is also incorrect. Next is the right to entry for collection of timber is allowed in reserved and protected. Now it is not allowed in reserve forest. So this statement is incorrect. So as of now, the answer for this question is, the reason for this statement is that in protected forest, sometimes the rights are given to the communities. So if there are any tribals living in that area, in the protected forest area, so they are being given the rights because they sustain their livelihood from these forests. So they are given the rights to these activities like hunting and grazing. Now these reserved and protected forests, they work on the upgradation basis. So they get an upgradation to wildlife sanctuaries, then to the national parks. And the very famous example of this is the Sariska National Park. So what happened was, Sariska National Park was first declared as a reserve forest in 1955. So it was a reserve forest in 1955. Then it was upgraded to wildlife sanctuary in 1958. Next, it became a tiger reserve in 1978. And in the year 1992, it became the national park. So it's important that how Sariska National Park was upgraded to national park from reserve forest. Now you need to tell me in the comment section below that where is this Sariska National Park located. So tell me your answer in the comment section, where is this Sariska National Park located. Moving on to the next question. So according to the National Commission on Agriculture, it's important that National Commission on Agriculture submitted its final recommendation in 1976. So according to this National Commission on Agriculture, the forest can be classified into. So there are three categories in which the forests are being classified on the basis of National Commission on Agriculture. They are protection forest, production forest and social forest. Now we'll look into these three one by one. So as the name suggests, the first one, protection forest. In very simple terms, if we need to classify these protection forests, so they are the forests that basically mitigate the impacts of the natural hazard, for example, the landslides, the floods, the droughts. So to mitigate the effects of the natural hazards, these protection forests are being classified. So managing the forest for their protection function is known as the protection forestry. Next type of classification is production forest. So as the name suggests, production forest, they are used for the, or the objective of this forestry is to produce maximum quantity of timber and non-timber produce. So if we can get the produce of these forests for the industrial and commercial use, then we can classify them as the production forest. So the greater concern is regarding the economic return. But for the protection unit, if we consider, it's not the case. For protection, we are just using them as a protection, or they are working for the protection of the area. Next is the social forest. So we'll be discussing social forest in the next question. So next question is social forestry is. Now social forestry, if we need to classify it in a very simple term, so it is kind of democratic approach. Now what is democratic approach? So it's by the people, of the people and for the people. This is the basic agenda of social forestry. So how it is democratic approach? Let's look at these statements one by one. So it was initiated with the aim of taking the pressure of the forest and making use of all unused and fallow land. Now this is absolutely correct statement with respect to social forestry, because we cannot just rely on the forests which are already there. We need to grow more forests, and afforestation needs to be promoted. So to make use of all the unused and fallow land, it's the purpose of social forestry. Next is to aim it. So it aims at raising the plantation by the common man so as to meet the growing demand for timber. Now it's somewhat related to the democratic approach, because it needs to be done by the common man so that they could meet the growing demand for whatever forest produce we require. So it's also correct. Next is it involves the community participation as a whole as a part of drive towards afforestation. I already mentioned that we cannot do that alone. So it involves the community participation as a part of drive towards afforestation. So social forestry is somewhat the mixture of all these 3 points. So the answer of this question is all of these. Now, what comes to the objective of social forestry? That we need to meet the fuel demand, the woods demand, the fodder demand, the timber requirements. So how can we achieve these demands? It could be achieved only when we can grow more forest. So this is how we define social forestry, and this term was first used in 1976 by the National Commission on Agriculture. Remember this thing as well. Moving on to the next question. So the plantation of trees on the sides of canals, roads, etc., along with the planting on wasteland is known as. Now these all are the categories or classification of the social forestry. Now let's look at these one by one. Also, one very famous example of social forestry was eucalyptus. So there was this drive of planting eucalyptus on the sides of the road, so to promote the forestry. Now eucalyptus drive was famously known as the social forestry drive. Now coming back to the question, so what is farm forestry? So farm forestry is the type of forestry where the trees are included on the farmlands or grown on the farmland so that they could manage to produce the products like timber, oil and charcoal. So farm forestry is somewhat done simultaneously with the normal agriculture produce, and it's kind of the social forestry to promote the forest as well. Next is recreational forestry, which is kind of the forestry with the objective of creating scenic value. So as the name suggests, it is for the scenic value. So it's done or developed near the towns and cities so that people get encouraged to see the scenic beauty of that area. Next one is the extension forestry. So extension forestry includes the activity of raising trees on the farmland. So basically this definition is for the extension forestry. So the plantation of trees on the sides of the canals, roads, or the community forest area, the village wasteland, this is all being classified under the extension forestry. Next type of forestry is the community forestry. So community forestry is just the opposite of the individual forestry. Now community forestry is the extension of the forestry on the community land. So rather than doing, and it's being done by the community itself. So as the name suggests, it is not done on the individual land, but the trees are grown on the community land where the community as a whole has to work to grow the forest or to grow the trees. So it involves the involvement of the whole community for creating and managing of these forests. And it is for the benefit of the whole population of that land, not just restricted to one individual, which is in the case of the farm forestry. Next is the agroforestry, which is very important. So it's the definition. So definition says that it's the sustainable land management where the trees and the shrubs are combined with the crops and the livestock. So when we are growing the crops and the livestock and we are using the shrubs or the trees so that we could use it in the normal farm practices. So suppose we need to stop soil erosion. So trees are grown. So this is kind of the agroforestry where the trees are grown so that they could be used for the soil or the soil could be protected against soil erosion. So this is how we classify the social forestry in these different forms. Next question is, the following forests are known as the rainforest in India. So typically the forests in India are classified into alpine forest, tropical forest, temperate forest and subtropical forest. Now if we classify these tropical forests, so there are various subcategories. So for example, the wet evergreen, the semi evergreen, the deciduous forest, the dry deciduous forest, and the thorn forest. So this is how we classify the tropical forest. And these forests are known as the rain forest in India or evergreen forest. Reason being, we do not know when they are going to shed their leaves. Therefore, they are considered as the evergreen forest. This is a very basic definition of tropical forest. Now, if we need to categorize them or we need to study about them, so tropical forests are spectacular all over the plain region in India. So if we talk about this wet evergreen, so example could be Jamun. And their major occurrence is along the coastlines or Andaman and Nicobar, and the plateaus and the coastline. So Jamun is one of the example of wet evergreen. The semi-evergreen, we can take the example of mango. And for the deciduous, the moist deciduous, we can take the example of haldu. So this is how we classify the deciduous forest. These are found in Kerala, Maharashtra, Madhya Pradesh. Then we come to the dry deciduous, where these are found in UP, Bihar. And as the name suggests, thorn forest. So acacia is the major category, the most famous species of thorn forest. And these forests occur in the low rainfall area. Therefore, due to the scarcity of water, they are being categorized as thorn forests. So this is how we classify tropical forests. Now coming to the subtropical forests. So they are found in the, these are found in the high rainfall area. Basically the slopes of the mountains, but we cannot differentiate between the winter season and the summer season over here. So very, very famous examples are the oak, olives, chestnut. These are the example of the subtropical. Next, coming to the temperate forest. So temperate forests are basically found in the peninsular plateaus, the eastern Himalayan regions. So kind of found in the Sikkim, Himachal Pradesh, UP, you can find these temperate forests. Maple is the very famous example of temperate forest. Deodar is the very famous example of temperate forest. Last one is the alpine forest, the quantity of which is comparatively lower. So I have classified and explained them in terms of the quantity. So major one are the tropical, then comes the subtropical, then comes the temperate, and then comes the alpine forest. So alpine are found in the snow-capped mountains of the sub-Himalayan region. So this is how we classify the different forests found in India, and they're very important with respect to the examination as well. Now it's time for you to comment. Dash is the practice of controlling the growth, composition, health and quality of forest to meet diverse needs and values. Keep this thing in mind, it's related to forest. So I've made this question easier by highlighting this thing that it's related to forest. So you need to answer that in the comment section below. Also, do not forget to subscribe to our channel Anuj Jindal for more such videos, and do not forget to press the bell icon as well. We do not want you to miss on any of the videos as the exam is just around the corner. So watch these videos and get your concepts clear. We'll be coming up with the next video soon. Thank you so much for watching the video.